Hey, it's Fran, again, in the lab. Fran Lab. Well, you can just imagine my excitement the other day when I came home from the thrift store with this. $15. It's from 1977. It's the Tandy Digital Computer Kit. Seems like a lot of fun. Seems like fun. Let's check it out. So here we go. The digital computer kit. I got it home, had a good look at it, and realized that it's not really complete. Apparently, this thing came as a kit. Now, I've had these sort of experiment kits before, 101 kits and stuff, for various kinds of electronics that Tandy offered. The ones that I'd gotten before were assembled right in the box, but apparently this one was not originally. But it did come with this really cool book inside, and really the money that I paid for this was worth just to get this book, because it's got this really cool history of computers, pre-home computer age, and it even has this picture of the train wreck from the Apollo simulator, the train wreck. And the book is really just a time capsule in the pre-home computer age. It's got the Babbage difference engine. It's got Gottfried Wilhelm von Leibniz calculator. It's got the Census machine, ENIAC, a modern compact computer. And it outlines all of the various jobs that are available to you if you want to get involved in computers, from mechanical engineer, production foreman, programmer, systems analyst, key punch operator to punch in the keypads. You can be an assembler, people who assemble computers, not people who actually assemble assembly language. Electrical technician, quality assurance engineer to make sure those computers are top quality. Technical writer and technical illustrator, because you need people to make drawings with pencils and pens about, you know, how to use the computer. You need people who can draw stuff, you know. You get a customer engineer, someone who engineers customers, and a computer operator, a person who actually will actually operate the computer. What a thought. All those people. And it even says at the beginning, you need lots of people to operate computers. So this is the basic outline of how to put together the kit. And so apparently these various switch assemblies came like a model kit, and you put them all together. There were some circuit boards in there and wiring assemblies. There's a lot of wiring and crimping to do. But when I actually got it out, it didn't have any bulbs, and the electronics is all missing. So there are a few little sundry pieces in the bottom of the box. I got three bulb assemblies with bulbs, but just 3 out of 10. There's some sundry wiring in various parts, but it doesn't seem to, and even instructions on how to put together a completely different kit, which is not actually in here. So, but I thought, you know, I can wire this up. So, thought, why not put a little bit of time to finish this machine, get it working, and try out some of these cool experiments. There's 100 of them. Digital experiments. I'm eager to go. Let's give it a try. I'm going to get this operational. Okay, so the first thing that I noticed on this is this, and I thought this was a little bit of hookup wire, because you see the kit runs on these hookup wires that go in these little springs, and I thought this was some hookup wire wrapped around, but it isn't actually. Closer examination, it's actually a rubber band. What? Really? Okay, so I noticed that the switch is not actually like contacting here, so I flipped it over. You can see on the bottom side these switches, they have got pieces that slide. See the back piece slides when you push the switch in the front. And I can see here that on this one, one of the little plastic tabs has been snapped off. See, there's supposed to be two of these little tabs I guess the switch snaps in place. One of them was snapped off, so someone thought, oh, I'll just wrap a rubber band around that so that the switch holds together while I'm... and then I'll just, you know, put the switch in place, and of course it doesn't actually make contact because you see it's not flush here, so that ended up being a problem. So they thought, oh, so what I'll do is I'll just work out some epoxy, and I'll just epoxy that right to the... What? WTF! Look at this! Okay, so rather than epoxying the piece that breaks off here, I'm going to put a rubber band around it, and then I'm going to epoxy it into place where it's not actually in place. I'm going to epoxy it out of place. Man, what a botch job. It is such a botch job. So I'm going to have to snap that loose and file that down. Oh man, what a botch job. Actually, I don't think that really needs anything. It looks like that's actually going to stay in place without anything on it, so... Oh man, I don't know, I just... Ugh. WTF. Get in there. Oh yeah. Oof. Alright. Now I broke that tab off because the plastic is too old. Wouldn't bend, so now I've got to weld that in place as is without the rubber band. Great. Looks like it's time to bring out the old spin welder. Yeah, spin welding. I haven't done this in a while. Right. That's what I call a weld. A little flash on the other side. Get that off of there. All right. Properly welded. Alrighty. Yeah, that switch is fine. Don't need to do anything else. Seems that one tab will do just nicely. Okay. Now that's fixed. The next challenge is the lights. There's 10 lights that are supposed to be in here. And I've only got a couple of them. You can see. These are 3-volt bulbs with the sockets. Well, it turns out they actually still make these sockets, and I was able to order a whole bunch of them. It's pretty amazing, but it is actually, if I take the light bulb out, it's actually the exact same socket. It's just got the little flare on the end and everything. So, yeah. So, I'm just gonna, you know, replace the missing sockets with these, and I've even got some new old stock bulbs, 3-volt bulbs, so we're good to go with the incandescent. And people are going to say, how come you're not flipping over to LEDs? Why not use LEDs? Well, because it uses incandescents. They look different. And besides, it's already got the 3-volt 2C battery compartment built in, so, you know, I'm going to make it the way it's supposed to be. 3 volts, incandescent. So the next thing is this little... is the switch. Alright, you can see it's got a little mounting spot there. I got the button for the switch, but I don't have the actual switch. But that's okay. I've got this really cool micro switch that will work really well. It's thicker, it's got it's deeper than the switch that was originally in this, what I'm gonna do is just machine a couple of spacers and mount the switch on a little piece of perf board. Got a couple of these little buttons that'll be just the right height, and so I just have to drill a hole through there. Just gotta drill a couple holes in them. That'll be just about the right height with a piece of perf board to mount that switch. Oh, right about there. So here's the board, a little micro switch, ready to go. A couple of spacers, so a couple of screws. So made these spacers just out of some extra buttons I had, and the screws just came from my junk bin. That should fit right. Okay, here's the test. Oh, nice. I'm gonna get the mic close so we can hear that. Okay, here we go. Ooh, that's so nice. All right, awesome. I gotta cut a bunch of wire now, so. Actually, I wanted to show how I do it. The best way, if you're gonna cut a lot of wire, is to use little straws. I've done this for years, but I've got this whole set that I cut just different lengths of straws, and I mark them at different lengths. And so you never want to cut a length. Like this one is 2.75 inches, and it's so easy and fast to cut wire. Put the wire in the straw, and you just put your thumb over the end to hold it. You can cut it off, pull it out, do it over again, hold it down, cut it off. And you can cut wire really fast like this. If you get a rhythm going, you can just insert and cut, insert and cut. It's really the fastest way to cut wire. If you want to do, you know, 20 wires or 100 wires, it's really the only way to go. Short of a mechanical cutter, like an automated thing, it's the best way to do it by hand. A little straw. There you go. So, it's all together now. Hooked up, a working digital computer. Wow, in my own lab. A real digital computer. Oh, well, so I wanted to fire this up and try out its might. I don't know, the computing power of this thing, I don't know. Might be in the area of like 10 flops per minute, maybe, depending on how fast you can flick the switches. So I wanted to really try out the might of the computer. And there's 100 experiments that come in the booklet. Some of them seem pretty impressive, like periodic table of the elements, or counting, or a calculator. I don't know if you can really do real calculations. Subtraction, powers of two, doing roots. You know, sine and cosine functions, I doubt it could do that. Yeah, and even some electronic stuff like capacitors in parallel, calculation of combined series parallel capacitors seems pretty ambitious. Reactance calculations? I don't know. For a 10 register or 1 bit computer, that would be pretty impressive. Now I decided to go with program number 97. It's PNP or NPN transistors. There, yeah. Just because I liked the little screen that I had to slide in the little display thingamajigger. So, yeah, I think I've got enough hookup wire for this. So this is the mighty Tandy computer kit, and it really is pretty simple. Like you've seen inside, there's actually no electronics. There's no transistors, no op-amps in this. This is really just 10 light bulbs and some switches. So essentially, I guess what we're looking at here is 10 registers, right? And each one of these registers can be either on or off. That's it. It's just 10 registers, 10 bits. And each of these banks of switches here that represent each register, it's really just one double pole switch times 5. So there's like 10 switching choices, but it's really just if the switches are in the up position, then the top rows here are shorted. And if they're slid down to the bottom position, then the bottom pairs are shorted. So it's really just either that's on, or that's on, or that's on, or that's on. It's really just, you know, on or off two switches for each set. So it's not even really easy to see how this could really be a computer, except it's really just you're going to, depending on how you wire it, it's really just going to show you basic logic. You know, if not this, then that. Or if this and that, then that. Or if not that and not that, then that. That's really all you can do with this. So I've got this program number 97 loaded up right here. It's the PNP or NPN transistor. And there's a diagram here for how to wire it. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to wire it right now. Operations: select either of the transistor types, NPN or PNP, and push up on the slide switch under your choice. The schematic symbol for one you selected will light up in the answer line. Now, as you push up the slide switches one at a time under emitter, Q5, collector, Q7, and base, Q9, their terminal connections will light up in the answer line. Do not select more than one transistor type at a time. I wonder what would happen. Maybe it'd blow up. So, here we go. After like 25 minutes or so of tinkering this thing together. I have set up the program for PNP or NPN transistor. So now all I have to do is run the program. Do that, I select either NPN or PNP, so let's go with NPN. Oh, turned on the NPN transistor, okay. NPN transistor, so I can select emitter, and switches are a little old, okay. Emitter, which, okay, that's pointing to, that is the emitter, and if I turn on collector, oh, and that's showing the collector right there. And if I turn on base, oh, it shows the base. Or I can do base, collector, and emitter, theoretically. Turn them all on. Okay. Well, that was exciting. Okay. So, turn them all off now. Okay. That was NPN. Okay. It's good calculations. Let's try PNP. That came on. It's the PNP transistor. Alright, let's see here. I can turn on emitter. Oh, and that shows the emitter there. The collector. Okay, that's the collector right there. Nice. Okay. Learning a lot here. And base. Ah, it's the third one. But it says in the instructions, do not try to turn on NPN and PNP at the same time. Well, gee, what would happen? It all just conks out. Well, that was well worth a half an hour of setup. I've learned programming. I'm a genius. Not fun. Not fun at all. So, did you have as much fun as I did? I thought so. This is probably the most work for the least bit of fun that I've had in a long time. This is 1977, it's not 1955. There is so much more that they could have done with this. But they did not. You would have been a very disappointed little nerd kid to get this under your tree in the holidays. The Tandy Digital Computer Kit is, it's a thumbs down. I would give it double thumbs down, definitely. So anyway, live and learn. Not all old toys are fun. And not even all old toys are dangerous and fun. This is neither. Didn't catch fire, and I didn't learn anything, except that sometimes in the old days, you could really get disappointed buying a toy like that. So, anyway, that's it. And thanks to all my Patreon subscribers who are making all of these videos possible, including this really boring one. But hey, you know, it can't all be win-win. But thanks to everyone who sponsors me on Patreon. You make all these videos possible. And I'm Fran. I'll be back with something really exciting. I promise. The next one's going to be really exciting. Back at the lab. Fran Lab. Bye.